and welcome to this week's Movie Math, where, believe me, it is oh so tempting to make a video about Aquaman's likely billion-dollar accomplishment. But since he hasn't swum there just yet, but he's oh so close, instead today we're going to focus on the still impressive ocean of cash he does have. Although when he does hit that billion-dollar mark, we will have a special report. Anyway, Aquaman, forget Ocean Master, Aquaman is a box office master, uniting moviegoers across the globe under the DC banner in a much-needed win for Warner Brothers, proving the potency of one of its top franchises. Right now, pretty much its only franchise, as the other ones don't feel so good. Harry Potter is on the ropes. Did you see that Pottermore Pawnee tweet over the holidays? Ouch. Who looks over those things? I guess J.K. Rowling won the right or fought for the right, and Warner Brothers had no choice but to give it to her to kind of control her own empire. But I saw someone tweet in response to that she has a bad case of the George Lucas, and I've made that comparison myself, and I do think it's coming true. But anyway, also, Lord of the Rings is returning, but on streaming. Where to be fair, though, it could be a bigger hit than ever before. Ah, modern Hollywood. In fact, some of us even feel that streaming might be the best home for J.K. I don't know what editing is rolling. But thanks to James Wan, it's clear that DC is still a big screen property. Now, some of you might be like, Grace, you just said streaming was a big place that Lord of the Rings could have more success than ever before. That's true. Streaming has certainly given new life to many properties and careers. But at the end of the day, as I recently said when I guested it on Top 30, what's the biggest compliment you can pay something on the small screen? That it seems like a movie. All right, so, although side note, Warner Brothers is trying to get a streaming service off the ground for DC, the DC Universe, but right now they have to beg people to subscribe. I'm sure you caught that over the holidays. And based on the complete lack of online chatter for something like Young Justice, I mean, it arrived, I would say, you know, if it's like the whole if a tree falls in a wood and no one's there to hear it situation, right? If a show debuts on streaming but no one's subscribed, did it really debut? We'll see how these DC Universe shows do overseas where they're going to be playing on Netflix. But here, I think there ain't nobody at that party. They're all at Aquaman. Aquaman is definitely a party, enjoying his third weekend as the king of the box office. Likely to have a fourth win next weekend at number one, which would be the first time, as the trades have pointed out, that a Warner Brothers movie has been at the top of the box office for that long since The Dark Knight. Oh, excellent comparison. We're going to talk about Christopher Nolan's movies more in just a moment. But also, what's also impressive about Aquaman's weekly box office postings is that he has incredibly strong holds so far. And not only is Aquaman now the most successful film of the DCEU, that's so exciting, but it's the third most successful DC film period after Nolan's Knights. And overseas, Aquaman even beats those out, thanks to becoming the second most successful superhero film of all time in China, although naturally, of course, Infinity War is number one. Marvel! Kevin Feige, I think it's fascinating. Kevin Feige is listed as the only producer for Black Panther. So while Aquaman makes all this money, Kevin Feige, always ahead, might be going around picking up some incredible awards for his film Black Panther. Anyway, from Warner Brothers overall, back to Warner Brothers and Aquaman, Aquaman currently sits at number 12 for the studio of all-time hits. Excellent. And as Aquaman does swim towards a billion, I expect to be making that video probably sometime this week or at the very latest by next weekend. I'm sure the conversation at Warner Brothers has turned from, I can't believe it was Aquaman that saved us, to how do we keep James Wan in this franchise? Because while there was little question that Patty Jenkins would return for her sequel, Wan is a successful, prolific filmmaker coming in to Aquaman, and he already had a billion-dollar movie on his resume. In fact, it'll be interesting to see what the next moves will be for Wan as well as his stars, beyond Aquaman 2, of course, that sequel announcement likely being held up not just by the holidays, but negotiations with Wan. I'm actually not sure if he will return. As I pointed out in my DC No Respect video last week, I don't know if he's going to want to continue to fight this fight. He doesn't need to. You know, Patty Jenkins, what else is she going to do? James Wan, I think it would probably be on the short list for any studio after how well Aquaman has performed. So I'm not, he does have a good home at Warner Brothers. That's where he makes all his horror movies. But he might say to Warner Brothers, I want to stay in-house, but I don't want to be part of DC. I did my work. I helped you patch it up a little bit. I'd like to move on. They'd have to pay him so much money, but I think he's worth it. So I'm very curious to see how that situation develops with Wan. As for his stars, I'm sure they'll all return for the sequel. But what else will they get? Amber Heard and Jason Momoa, for instance, are currently the most popular celebs on IMDb. That even being tweeted out about over the past few days. And Amber Heard tweeting back, it's nice to be talking about something else besides Johnny Depp. No, she didn't tweet that, but I'm sure that's how she and her team feel. Although she brings him up a lot herself, so if I were her, I would move on from that and focus on this incredible opportunity for her. It seemed her career was dead, but she might actually become a major star, or at least have a chance to be. They're not the Amber Heard and Jason Momoa aren't the greatest of actors. So, and James Wan was very kind to them and very, very protective. And I hope that when they choose their other projects, they keep that in mind and don't buy into their own hype. They're not like, I knew I was amazing all along. They'd be like, I need a filmmaker who cares about me and protects me as much as James Wan did. Anyway, as for actors that James Wan is looking out for, Patrick Wilson, he's only number 32 on the IMDb celeb-o-meter. But don't worry about him, because he'll likely continue as a key member of the House of Wan, with, of course, Annabelle 3 coming up with him and Vera Farmiga taking over those spin-off movies. Now, it's also important that Warner Brothers was able to duplicate Sony's Jumanji success with a tropical comedic epic adventure at Christmas. This is a thing! Because Jumanji, sure enough, next film, it has December 2019 already locked up, while Avatar, who started this whole thing, although nobody thought they could possibly repeat it, although now, again, this has become the norm for the Christmas season. Avatar supposedly will return December 2020 and 2021. Now, some of you might be typing right now, so what if Aquaman made a lot of money, Grace? It's just another Venom, proving that that the masses like junk movies just as much as they like junk food. Well, first off, junk food serves an important, part of society, and it's awfully tasty. But I don't think that I would make that. I think Venom does have that comparison, although I think Aquaman... after all, Aquaman is still barely fresh on Rotten Tomatoes, by the way, but it is fresh. A refreshing change of pace for DC movies. And of course, it was snubbed for a VFX nomination, as I tweeted about when it first happened, and now James Wan, who must be so upset about it because he's so adverse to having controversy, he actually said the same thing that I did with it being an effing disgrace, and he was quoted across the internet, because that's a darn good headline. But to come out so strongly against his peers, was an interesting move indeed. Just again to show you how upset he must be. And also I think he feels he has the audience support. Although with DC, that hasn't really mattered so far. In terms of going up against the industry and critics and the media, etc. We'll get to those guys in just a moment. But the truth is that Aquaman is already a much bigger hit than Venom. It has a higher cinema score. It's in the A's. It's already $100 million ahead of Venom, more so, and is pretty around $100 million ahead, and it's pretty much guaranteed to join the billion-dollar club. And then also, while its overseas box office is impressive, where it opened first, keep in mind, it's currently building an impressive domestic haul as well. And that's important, because it shows that Aquaman is not one of those movies that foreign audiences had to save, that was rejected by domestic. Domestic audiences are embracing it. It's swimming very quickly toward past $300 million. And remember, it's difficult for a movie to break even into $400 million. We've had some big hits this year, thanks to Marvel, and largely Disney, which make it seem like it's easy to get into those high numbers domestically. It is not. Aquaman, to be fair, should end up somewhere in the 300s, and I think it will, to be considered a strong domestic player. But 400 is tough. That was impressive that Wonder Woman, another DC movie, managed to accomplish that. And remember, only Glass is on the horizon, but it will take away Aquaman's IMAX screen. So if you want to see Aquaman again in IMAX, you got to do it before Glass hits theaters. But otherwise, Warner Brothers still has until February 8th to soak up a lot of cash domestically. We'll see how far it gets. So yeah, as I detailed again in that video last week, respect is still a problem for DC movies with critics, the media, and the industry. But thankfully, audiences have shown they are still very open to seeing DC movies, even after Justice League. So that is an incredible accomplishment by James Wan. And in terms of audience appeal going forward, the upcoming DC slate seems solid, if not outright strong. Plus, such incredibly strong audience support should at least signal to the media, who are audience-dependent for clicks, that it's no longer fashionable to trash DC movies. They wouldn't keep doing it if they weren't getting clicks. So there's still that contingent that likes to diss DC, but I think, hopefully they'll see that, positivity is also welcome now as well. Now, as for the rest of the weekend box office, Sony continues to be the comeback kid, with this time a small victory for Escape Room. The low-budget horror film played to diverse audiences and with little spent on advertising. I didn't see it anywhere, really, did you? It will surely turn a profit for Sony before making even more money on streaming. Then, Mary Poppins Returns, Spider-Verse, and Bumblebee continue to cannibalize each other at the holiday box office, all stuck together in a box office knot, none of them really making as much money as they should. Now, Mary Poppins Returns and Spider-Verse are both hoping to break free of that knot with awards wins, starting tonight with the Golden Globes, which I'll be live tweeting, so I hope that you will watch with me, and I'll be reviewing afterwards. Speaking of the Golden Globes, Vice is also a long way from turning a profit for Megan Ellison. Remember, her father felt that her investment in Vice, around $60 million, not including advertising, was such a bad one that he's in the midst of taking her company away from her, or at least, you know, doing an audit of it and seeing what should be the next steps, because he's her primary investor. So the Adam McKay pick badly needs some wins tonight as well to keep that box office coming in. But Clint Eastwood is doing just fine off in his own little world, as he has for a while now, as The Mule will surely cross the century mark sometime this month. But things aren't going nearly as well for Will Ferrell, who has yet another bomb with Holmes and Watson, which is almost out of the top 10 already in just its second weekend. A movie so bad that not only was it not previewed for critics, forcing many critics to have to go and trudge out to see the movie on Christmas Day, but Netflix wouldn't even buy it when Sony tried to pawn it off on them. Next up for Ferrell is a movie co-starring and directed by James Franco. Uh-oh, clearly that was signed before the whole James Franco career implosion. I don't know if James Franco is going to be able to come back from that. I think he would have by now. But, you know, at least Will Ferrell is launching a hotly anticipated Ron Burgundy podcast early this year. I'm going to call it now. Ferrell will be the next big star who's kind of ruined his career and needs a refresh to go to streaming. In fact, if I were Netflix, Amazon, or Apple, I'd be on the phone with his agent right now. I'd be like, yeah, don't worry. I'm going to come in here and swoop in here and save you guys. And the process probably get you for a steal. Okay, so as for this coming weekend, only minnows are set to go up against Aquaman, with A Dog's Way Home and The Upside battling it out for second place after Arthur. Then we can add Keanu Reeves to the list of actors who should not produce. He's doing this to himself. So that's this week's Movie Math. Thanks for going over the box office with me. I look forward to hearing your thoughts down below. And of course, as always, you can check out some more videos right now.